In today's khutbah, I would like to begin with a saying from Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salat wa salam. Where he talks about five important issues, where he says, "Usikum bi khams, law darabtum ilayha abat al-ibil, lakanat lidhalika ahlan." He says, "These five things, if you go in search of it, even if you have to ride fast camels to look for it, it is worth it." It's just a symbolic way of saying that this is important, and you should strive to acquire these five things. The very first one, he says, لَا يَرْجُونَ أَحَدٌ مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا رَبَّهُ. You should not place your hope in anyone but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whenever you have any issues, you know, the first point or the first thought should be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, he fulfills your wishes through the wasail, through the wasila, and that is the reality. But in your mind, the first thought should be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the very first important issue is that he says, always have hope in the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, he talks about a fear. وَلَا يَخَافَنَّ إِلَّا ذَنْبُهُ. And that you should not fear anyone but your own sins. Have hope in Allah and fear your own sins. You know, it's interesting that when we look at the Islamic perspective, sometimes we see that, you know, especially the Christian missionaries of the past, they would say that, oh, you know, our God is God of love, and your God is very, you know, vengeance. He will be punishing you and this and that. What they do not realize that when we talk about taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is normally translated as fear of Allah, it's not fear of the person of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We fear our own sins and the implication of our own sins, which makes us liable for the punishment by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the fear here, Amir al-Mu'mineen is saying that if you really have to fear anything, fear your own sins. Then he talks about the third issue. He says, وَلَا يَسْتَحِيَّنَّ أَحَدُكُمْ إِذَا سُئِلَ عَمَّ لَا يَعْلَمْ أَنْ يَقُولْ لَا أَعْلَمْ. That if you are ever asked about something that you do not know, you don't know about it, do not feel ashamed to say, I don't know. This word, I don't know, this is not actually confession of your ignorance. This is the key to knowledge. Once you realize you don't know, what will happen? Then you will go and find out what is the answer to this. And so this statement that, you know, I don't know is not really a negative point. You know, we have to realize, and this is what Amir al-Mu'mineen says, if you are asked about anything and you don't know, simply say, I don't know. Don't be ashamed to say these words. And then he goes on, number four, وَلَا يَسْتَهِ وَلَا يَسْتَحِيَّنَّ أَحَدٌ إِذَا لَمْ يَعْلَمْ شَيْئًا يَتَعَلَّمَهُ. There should be no shame. Once you realize you don't know something, there should be no shame in going and learning it. So they are connected to one another here. And then the final statement, وَعَلَيْكُمْ بِالصَّبْرِ. It says, I urge you to exercise and practice patience, endurance, sabr. Why? فَإِنَّ الصَّبْرَ مِنَ الْإِيمَانِ كَالرَّأْسِ مِنَ الْجَسَدِ. Because patience in relationship to iman and faith is like the relationship of the head to the body. لَا خَيْرَ فِي جَسَدٍ لَا رَأْسَ مَعْهُ. There is no benefit in a body which doesn't have head with it. وَلَا خَيْرَ فِي إِيمَانٍ لَا صَبْرَ مَعَهُ. There is no good in that iman and faith where there is no sabr. And this is something so important that even in Surah Al-Asr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where he talks about iman and amal salih, and he talks about haqq, he also ends with the issue of sabr. And so what we see here is basically the first statement is about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, put your hope and trust in Allah. Number two, when he talks about God, basically there are two items, the issue of, you know, this hope and fear of your own sins, which will make you liable for the azab from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he talks about two things about ourselves, where he says, do not be ashamed to say, I don't know, and don't be ashamed to learn that what you don't know. Ending with the quality that he wants to see in each one of us, and that is patience and endurance. When we talk about knowledge, it's interesting. When I was looking at this saying in Nahl al-Balagha, this is saying number 82. Just before that, there were two or three sayings from Ali relevant to knowledge. In one, he says, قِيمَةُ كُلِّ إِمْرَئٍ مَا يُحْسِنُهُ. He says, if you really want to know the worth of a person, the value of a person, it depends on what he knows, how much he knows. So basically, you know, the worth of a human being is according to the knowledge that the person has. Even when it comes to the issue of sadaqat, you know, charity, one of the criteria emphasizes that see those who have ilm and they are practicing and they are in need. A saying before that, he says, Al-hikmatu dhallatul mu'min. He says, wisdom is actually the lost property of a believer, of a mu'min. فَخُذُ الْحِكْمَةَ وَلَوْ مِنْ أَهْلِ النِّفَاقِ. So therefore, go and seek the wisdom, even if it comes from a hypocrite. Because it is a mu'min's property, go and seize that. That belongs actually to you. The same statement, in an earlier saying there, he says, خُذُ الْحِكْمَةَ أَنَّا كَانَتْ, you know, go and seek the wisdom from whatever place that you see, whatever source. فَإِنَّ الْحِكْمَةَ تَكُونُ فِي صَدْرِ الْمُنَافِقِ. It is possible that there might be hikmah and wisdom in the heart of a hypocrite. فَتَلَجْلَجُ فِي صَدْرِهِ. You know, it is actually fluttering. Doesn't want to stay in that heart of a munafiq. It wants to come out in order to be in the right place, and that right place is fi sadr al mu'min, in the heart of a mu'min and a believer. Salawat upon Nabi Barak. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the potential of knowledge to everyone. We just have to go and seek that wisdom, and sometimes it might even come from those who are munafiq, for example. However, you have to realize you should be able to distinguish between what is wisdom and what is garbage. That is important. Not everything, you know, coming from munafiq or others, you just take it. You know, the issue is that if you really have that ability to realize that this is true knowledge, this is wisdom, it doesn't matter whether it comes from a Muslim or a non-Muslim source. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to be among the true followers of Muhammad and Ali Muhammad salawatullah alayhi majma'een. Even if you look at the very first conclusion of the battle of Uhud, Battle of Badr, where first time, you know, Muslims became victorious in that first battle with Mushrikeen of Mecca, although they were outnumbered twice. They were about 900 on this side of the Mushrikeen and only 313 on the side of the Prophet, the Muslims were able to get about 70 prisoners of war. Those days, the tradition was that when you have prisoners of war, there are only two solutions. Either you kill them or you make them slaves. Quran talks about it, and Prophet said that there is a third way. We can ask their tribe or their family to pay fidya, and then they are free to go. However, he put a condition. He says, those prisoners of war who are mushrikeen of Mecca, who have the talent of literacy, they know how to read and write, their freedom depends on them teaching 10 Muslim children how to read and write. This is where the Prophet is using the talent of a mushrik in order to promote literacy among Muslim children. Salawat Pranay Parar. إن أحسن الحديث كتاب الله العزيز بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوب وهو الغفور الرحيم ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العتوف للعباد بجوده والعواد على المذنبين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه سيد المرسلين والشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة أوصيكم عباد الله بالتوبة عما سلف من ذنوبكم. In this second khutbah, I would like to briefly talk about a controversy which has started in India these days. Unfortunately, by somebody who comes from a Shia background, although his family has disowned him because of his statements, and actually he even comes from a Syed family. That doesn't guarantee anything, anyway. Waseem Rizvi, nothing to do with me. He basically started, he's more a politician than anything else, and he started propagating an idea a few months ago where he came up with a booklet saying that there are 28 verses in the Qur'an which are not actually part of the Qur'an. You know, ignorance compounded in ignorance. Somebody who has not, doesn't even know Arabic, has no background in religious studies. You know, he says these are the 28 verses of the Qur'an which promote violence, and these are the verses which are the basis of terrorism which is going on around the world. It's not only an issue of ignorance, he is just using the right-wing statements that you see even in the Western part of the world against Islam and the Prophet. And of course, it is coupled with his political motives to gain favor with the Hindu fundamentalist elements in the present government of India. He has been welcomed by, you know, the BJP, especially the very extreme elements of that party. And as I said, whatever he is saying about this ayat of Quran is nothing new. You know, the anti-Muslim groups in North America and Europe, they do this. They take a verse of the Quran out of the context, and then they say, see, Islam is promoting violence. Actually, in the year 2006, I had come up with five booklets on the Prophet of Islam. And one of them was entitled as Peace and Jihad in Islam. This was published by Nasimco at that time, and it is available for free download even now. And in there, I have discussed the example of how they take the text of the Quran out of the context. The whole issue is text and the context. They would take one sentence from a longer ayat, forget what is before it, what is after it, what was the background, whether it is general or specific to an event, and then they say, see, this is what it is. And I actually began by using the same method they have about the Bible. I said, even I can take a sentence from a long passage in the Bible and just say, see, this is what Jesus or Christianity was promoting, and that would not be the right way of looking at it. And so Waseem basically is just repeating what the right-wing groups in the West have been saying about Islam, Quran, and the Prophet of Islam. Recently, just about in the last 10 days, he came up with another booklet. Now, taking the image of the Prophet of Islam himself. He's no more a Muslim anyway, because he says, I only believe in God. I don't believe in the Quran. I don't believe in Muhammad. And he's basically trying to project the Prophet as a man of violence, and he's the one who has instigated everything, and this has nothing to do with God. And this whole issue of, you know, the Hindu fundamentalist group in India at the moment, they just look at the past history and they say, Muslims ruled on us. And so they are asking Muslims, you are Muslims by force. You were converted by force. And this is where it's important, and I talked about this issue in one of those five books. Actually, one of them is about how did Islam spread. And there I have talked about different parts of the world, especially when it comes to Middle East, South Asia, as well as Indonesia. And it's interesting to see that although Muslims ruled India for 800 years, but Muslims were never in majority. That itself says quite a lot. And I use this term many times, that these Muslim rulers, whether the Khulafa of early days or others who came later on, they were not in the business of spreading Islam. They were in the business of expanding the Muslim empire by military force, no doubt about it. But their objective was to dominate other societies, other countries. But they were not there to force Islam on the people. And you see that, you know, for example, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, a later Khalifa of Banu Umayyah, once he wrote a letter to the governor of Iran and the governor of Egypt. Persia and Egypt were the frontier provinces those days of the Muslim Empire. And he wrote to them that, you know, we have been ruling these areas for many, many decades. How come they have not become Muslim? And one of them responded back to him by saying that if they become Muslim, who will pay the jizya to us? Jizya is the tax imposed on non-Muslims. So their main business was to make sure whatever they are, as long as they are paying the tax, we are happy with that. So they were not in the business of spreading Islam. Even in India, if you look at a very prominent journalist and historian of India, Dr. Khushwant Singh, he has a book, A History of the Sikhs. In beginning, he talks about this, the Muslim rule in India, and he very clearly says, Islam was spread in India not by the Muslim rulers, but by the Muslim spiritual masters and missionaries. You go all the way to Indonesia. No Muslim army went there, unlike India or other places. You know, they became Muslim through their contacts with the Muslim merchants who went there. It was the akhlaq, the honesty, the truthfulness of the Muslim merchants which influenced them. And that's a lesson for us. Now that we have come here to the West, we have a heavy burden. We don't need to promote Islam by words and books and video programs and this and that. The main way, the most important way of spreading Islam is by our akhlaq and our behavior and our interaction with non-Muslims. When they see the honesty in you, when they see the truthfulness in you, when they see that this is a person who doesn't cheat in his dealings, this is where they will be impressed with you, and they might ask you, you know, what is the source of all this goodness and your character? And you say, I'm a Muslim. They might be surprised, because what we see about Islam and Muslims in the media is something else. What I see in you is something else. And that will be a more powerful response to the stereotyping than publishing books and having seminars and things like that. And so we have to take this as a lesson for ourselves, that inshallah, you know, by our action, as Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wa salam says in one of his sayings, he says, kuna du'at, be the missionaries of Islam, bi ghayri al-sinatikum, without using your tongue, means by your behavior. And that is the main thing that we have to realize. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take away the resources of those who are trying to tarnish the image of the Prophet of Islam, who is the rahmatun lil alameen sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala sayyidil mursaleen wa shafi'il mudhunibin nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وعلى إمام المتقين وأمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان. ما أحيا آثار البدع والطغيان أحاد بأبنية الشرك والنفاق حاسد فور البغي والشقاق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آباء الكرام ما اتصلت الليالي والأيام. اللهم عجل فرجه وسحل مخرجه واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى. إن الله يعمل بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون.